welcome once again to Primetime Wrestling. I'm Gorilla Monsoon, flanked by the Brain, and over in Studio B, of course, is the Hot Rod, who's having a killing problem today. Something's bothering him.
Once you get a weasel in your house, you can't get them damn fly.
I got some special news for all our primetime viewers. I want to get this off my chest right away because it is exciting. It is special. It's something that I think everyone's going to be proud of, Brian, when we finally put this thing together.
Survivor Series Showdown.
November 12th is the date. Mark it on your calendar. It will happen right here on the USA Network on Primetime Wrestling. Survivor Series Showdown, starting time 7 p.m. 5 exclusive matches getting ready for Survivor Series. We're going to have some further information for you later on in the program about these matches, how these matches were made up. But right now,
it's a Sunday, you know.
I know it's a Sunday.
Well, tell the humanoids.
Hot Rod, you all right over there? You're banging away.
I'm doing great. Well, I was clearing flies. First of all, that he always gets mad when I say hello to you first, Gorilla. Hello, Mr. Root Canal. It's wonderful. The Root only Canal. Guy since he's got this argument with Root and me gone, only person that's shedding more tears is Tammy Faye, man. Of course, I've been reading this book about Betty's Diary, some of the finer reading Bobsy left here under the couch here. Betty's Diary, how Boobsy invests in the stock market. Get King Haku.
Whose money? Take.
I invest my members sure, of my family's money quite well.
With or without their knowledge, I assume.
I got a question for that.
I have total card blanche.
I got a question. Yo-ho, Rennie, I got a question. How come if you're so doggone rich and you're from Beverly Hills, you're the only one that ain't got a tan?
Allergic to the sun, perhaps.
I wear a hat when I play golf.
You wear a hat when you play golf.
I don't have time to go to tanning booths.
We've got some tremendous matches lined up here this week on Primetime Wrestling. Our feature, of course, Brutus the Barber Beefcake taking on the Hammer Valentine. But right now, we're going to go down to ringside. Take a look at Mr. Perfect.
We have a tremendous crowd on hand here in Louisville at the Gardens. Tony Schiavone along with Lorne Alfred Hayes. We're not too far away, Alfred, as you know, from the Survivor Series. A lot of excitement around the entire world about that big event, but before we talk about that,
252 pounds and hailing from Downers Grove,
we have to pause here for the genius.
Genius!
I know you always enjoy this, Alfred.
I do.
It takes a real genius to appreciate perfection. Mr. Perfect has exactly what it takes. Hulk Hogan will not stand a chance, for he is less than perfect. I respect a man who never makes mistakes. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Mr. Perfect.
Okay, the announcement made by the genius about Mr. Perfect to go up against Reno Riggins. Quite an entrance here.
Yes, that was an introduction that certainly merited a lot of admiration for me.
And certainly what this man does in the ring, Mr. Perfect, merits a lot of admiration also. A perfect record, a lot of confidence, and apparently now a man at his side in the genius. And what do you think the genius can do for Mr. Perfect's career?
Well, going with what he's achieved already, Mr. Perfect, as you said, a 100% record, I don't know what the genius can do to attribute to him, but together they do make a deadly, deadly combination.
Reno Riggins and Mr. Perfect set to go. Mr. Perfect, a part of the Survivor Series. He is on the team with Rick Rude and the Rougeaus, aptly named Rude's Brood, and they'll go up against Roddy's Rowdies. And what a confrontation that'll be when Rowdy Roddy Piper, the Superfly Jimmy Snuka, and the Bushwhackers go up against Rude's Brood. Alfred?
Well, the Roddy's Rowdy's combination is a very, very exciting grouping. The Superfly Snuka on top of his form, and the Bushwhackers, Luke and Butch, and everybody loves them.
No question about that, as the genius looks on. Sending Mr. Perfect into the ropes. He comes off with a good shoulder attack. Oh, sending the man down to the ropes on the far side. Reno Riggins with a very surprised look on his face. Well, that was a tremendous move.
They were great, great moves there by Mr. Perfect. Executed perfectly, of course, in his inimitable style.
Side headlock by Mr. Perfect onto Riggins. The referee, Danny Davis, checking in. And back now to the ropes, sending Perfect to the other side. One too many times, Mr. Perfect comes off again. Nicely done with the leapfrog, and then a great dropkick, showing his agility.
Tony Riggins is a very fine young wrestler, but he's being made to look mediocre by this assault by, of course, Mr. Perfect.
You're right, Alfred. Mr. Perfect, total domination here with a snapmare takedown. And stomps Riggins in the back of the head as he tries to get up. Here he comes again, holding onto the head and going over the top with a somersault. At every point, great execution here by Mr. Perfect. And certainly, you talk about the Survivor Series, the Thanksgiving night tradition coming up. You have to be in great condition because basically, Alfred, you could get in a four-on-one situation because once you lose, you got to go back to the dressing room.
Yes, and if you take the team that Mr. Perfect is in, Rude's Brood, any one of those men, they're in great, great condition. In fact, what a well-conditioned team they all are. The Rougeos, Mr. Perfect, and of course the captain himself, Rick Rude.
But what a confrontation and what a challenge they have against Roddy's Rowdies. As a right hand finds its mark once again. And Riggins is dropped again. Now, Mr. Perfect with the Irish whip into the ropes. Oh, he nailed him that time. That was almost like a clothesline, even a forearm shot. And I'm now telling everybody about the perfect place.
Yes, I've never seen him. He looks so devastating. Look at the genius looking at his man there in the ring, Mr. Perfect. What an incredible display of efficiency.
There it is, the perfect plex. And look at the bridge, Alfred, on the perfect plex. A flawless record for
Mr.
Perfect.
Winner, Mr. Perfect.
So Mr. Perfect comes away with another win, a very important win, knowing that Survivor Series is down the road, and with the genius at his side, it was quite a victory for a very competent man.
And that Thanksgiving night tradition will go along, as it always does, with fantastic competitors such as Mr. Perfect, who's achieving a great victory here over Reno Riggins with his perfect plex. What a tremendous, tremendous performance this is by Mr. Perfect.
All right, your winner, Mr. Perfect. And now let's go back to our primetime studios and our host, Gorilla Monsoon, and Roddy Piper.
Mr. Perfect looking good here this week on Primetime Wrestling.
That moron, Tony Giovanni. Go back to Gorilla Monsoon and Piper. What am I? Just sitting here holding papers?
Chopped liver. I think he referred to you as chopped liver. I'm not sure.
I like that one, Gurr.
You know, we're going to have for you in this particular edition of Primetime Wrestling and next week as we go along. And before we reach our date, when November 12th, when our special Survivor Series showdown will air
Sunday
at 7 p.m., we're going to tell you exactly how these matches were derived. You know that there are 10 teams in the Survivor Series. Four members on each team, so 40 names went into a hat. Is that correct, Hot Rod? Am I?
40 names went into a hat. And the thing about it is, the beauty of this is we're going to get a chance to feel out the opponents. You see, a lot of these guys have been training as a team, and some of them haven't been there. Everybody's individual. And what they did is Jack Tunney went to his office, and he put 40 names in a hat, and we picked out one name from each team that are going to be competing on the 12th. And it should be a great, I'm going to watch it personally, because it's going to give me an idea of exactly what the other teams are thinking. So I'm excited myself.
Another big point of interest right here this week on Primetime. We're going to see from Saturday night's main event, the Hulkster taking on the Million Dollar Man. You won't want to miss that. Survivor Series, Thanksgiving night in Chicago. The ramifications involved in that are so vast and so huge. Well, you're going to see what we're talking about right now as we go to this special update with Mean Gene Okerlund and something that happened in the main event.
From the pages of the World Wrestling Federation magazine, here's Update. Hi again, folks. Last weekend on Saturday night's main event, the singles matchup between Tito Santana and Rick Martel developed into a full-scale war. Let's join that action in progress.
Santana's getting up. Martel better make his move. Santana rocks the rope. Martel loses his balance.
Martel might be a soprano now, McMahon.
Santana pummeling away. Martel in big trouble.
This is the most trouble that either competitor has been in throughout the course of this match.
Backing off now, powering away. Martel, Santana will hear none of it. Look at this. Santana the aggressor.
Now, why don't you say got him by a handful of hair, McMahon? Chico's breaking as many rules as anybody in this match.
You have to fight fire with fire sometimes, Jesse. Martel now went to the buckle. And out and down to the canvas. Here he goes. Santana's going to wind him up. Figure four roadblock is going to be applied to him and Slick is up on the apron. Now he's not. Santana leveled Slick. Boss Man's in the ring. What's it? Look at this. Dusty Rhodes is in there as well.
Uh-oh. We got a battle royale now, McMahon. We got them all in there now. Total chaos. Obviously, the match going to be no contest. Throwing out lucky for Chico Santana.
Boss Man kicking away on Dusty Rhodes. Hakeem over on Beefcake. Rooster in. Honky Tonk going in. And Martel is up right up behind him.
Who'd have thought we'd have a battle royale on Saturday night's main event? Totally unannounced, McMahon.
Martel over the top rope. And it looks like Hakeem is the only one left in the ring from the Slickster side, and he's gone now as well.
And Chico raising his hand like he won or something. Who's he kidding?
We'll see these teams go at it one more time on Thanksgiving night on the Survivor Series, a tag team elimination. There won't be any more Tier 4 Royal Rumble like this.
A double disqualification.
You can bet this one's far from over, McMahon. This is just the beginning.
Ironically, in the Thanksgiving night tradition, Tito Santana and Rick Martel will be on opposing teams. Santana on Dusty Rhodes' dream team, and Rick Martel joins Captain Big Boss Man and the Enforcers. The battleground is Chicago. The event is the Survivor Series. Be part of it Thanksgiving on a pay-per-view basis. For Update, I'm Gene Okerlund.
I told you it was mayhem, and it's going to remain mayhem until Survivor Series is over.
The only thing that saved Santana is that he took a cheap shot on Slick.
Saved Santana?
Martel had him going.
Will you be smart?
Martel was just about ready to reverse that figure four leg lock.
He was.
From the vantage point I had.
You knew that.
Well, yes, from my vantage point.
Studio B, do you agree?
It's a miracle that a man
that I can sit here and put up with this,
yes,
right?
Can make so much money and know so little about what he's talking about.
Right,
I want to see
could be talking
Tito.
About you.
I know I'm talking about you, boobs. I want to see Tito Santana go against the Big Blob Man myself. You know, I want to see. Of course, the Big Blob Man, he can go there and eat 16 Twinkies before a match, and he can take his Twinkies. I don't take that away from him. But I want to see him go against Tito Santana. When Tito Santana starts rocking and rolling, there ain't very many people that can stop that guy. And I don't think the Big Blob Man's one of them. Of course, boobs, I suppose you don't agree with me just because you're you.
Rod, you're going to get your wish because that's one of the matches that was drawn out of the hat. Tito Santana. Against the Big Boss Man. That will air November 12th.
I wish
right
I
here
bet you on that.
On Primetime Wrestling, our special. Don't forget the date. Sunday, November 12th. Right now, let's take a look at Rugged Ronnie Garvin.
The following contest is scheduled for one fall.
Toledo, Ohio, geared currently up for the World Wrestling Federation. You got to get geared up when you're going up against
Tony
a man like Rugged
Burton.
Ronnie Garvin. We take a look at Tony Burton.
And
he is the man who has
Charlotte,
to face
Carolina,
Rugged Ronnie Garvin. Rugged Ronnie Garvin, Lord Alfred Hayes, one of the men involved
Ronnie
in the Survivor
Garvin.
Series. And he's on a real rough and rugged team himself because he's on the 4x4s with the mighty Hercules, Bret the Hitman Hart, and Hacksaw Jim Duggan.
And Duggan, the captain of that mighty team of 4x4s. But what a position they're going to face on things on the Thanksgiving night tradition. They're going against the King's Court.
And that King's Court made up, of course, of the captain, the Macho King, Randy Savage, Greg the Hammer Valentine, Dino Bravo, and the Widowmaker. Right now, though, Garvin locking up with Burton. And Garvin is such a powerful man. Big right hands or shoves, whatever he wants to do, and he sends Tony Burton right to the floor.
A very compact figure, Ronnie Garvin, just a tremendous wrestler.
Looking on the other side of the ring during the Survivor Series, one of the men on the King's Court is Greg the Hammer Valentine.
You know, Rugged Ronnie Garvin, I'm sick and tired of you thanking me for putting you back into wrestling. What you're not going to thank me for is what I'm going to do to you in the Survivor Series.
Well, some threatening words that time, Alfred, from the Hammer.
Well, he can back them up. Make no mistake about that. And he's really, really got something going against Garvin, because he blames him for everything that's happened to him, and he's right too.
Now Garvin trying to escape. On to Burton with a two count that time. Great counter move by Rugged Ronnie Garvin. We talk so much about his right hand and those lethal blows that he puts in, but he can wrestle also, showing some moments right there as he goes right to a wrist lock.
Maybe we've got a chance to see that lethal right hand of his. He uses the palm of his hand right down at the very base to knock his man out.
And he goes down, Alfred, from a right hand from Burton that time. I think it's stunning. We didn't expect it. Neither did Garvin, but Burton wants to do it again. And the block! There it goes, Alfred. You said we would see it, and down goes Burton a second time.
And he follows up with that headbutt, which is always devastating as well. And I'm afraid Burton may have started something here he'll be very sorry for.
Burton caught into the corner, and Garvin just wailing away at him. Now, sending Burton for the ride. Backdrop. Rugged Ronnie Garvin stomping away now at Burton. Here's a Garvin stomp.
And he makes sure they're well and truly down and out before he puts that on them. But that usually is the sign of everything is finished for his opponent.
Looks out to the crowd here in Toledo, and now ties up Burton for the reverse figure four. You can see it, and there it is. A message to the hammer and a message to everyone involved on King's Court that Rugged Ronnie Garvin is ready for the Survivor Series.
Here is your winner, Rugged Ronnie Garvin.
What a business-like performance that was there by Rugged Ronnie Garvin, and what a message he's sending with that reverse figure four to Greg Valentine, and in fact, the whole of the King's Court. A wonderful, wonderful victory for Rugged Ronnie Garvin.
Rugged Ronnie Garvin with a tremendous win. He's ready for the Survivor Series. Now let's go back to our primetime studios.
Indeed, he is getting ready, Rugged Ronnie Garvin, for Survivor Series. What do you mean he's been hanging around with Tito?
Didn't you see him do that Garvin stomp?
Yes.
Well, he picked that up from an old flamingo dancer
in
Juarez.
Stop.
Same thing, the way they dance.
It's not the same at all.
Seems to be working, though, Boobs. I like that Garvin is trying to beat Valentine at his own game. He's got his own figure four, his own specialty, and Valentine, he's kind of got the same problem that Bobby does. He's got a virus in his computer. And what's going to happen is they're going to get confused here, and Garvin's going to go for the figure four. And you watch, Valentine can become a soprano himself. Candy.
That's a team captain that's talking now, so.
That's the team captain from Rowdy's Rowdy's.
That's right.
I know who that moron is over there.
I'm sorry. Now, Boobsy, no hard feelings. Let's just clear the air right now, Boobsy.
Good, you're going to leave?
Sometimes you just kill me. Sometimes I'd like to, you.
Studio B having a good time this week here on Primetime Wrestling. We'll be right back after this.
Survivor Series, one of the premier World Wrestling Federation events, heads your way on Thanksgiving night. It's a Thanksgiving night tradition. Don't miss the Survivor Series.
You know, folks, a lot of people asking me, well, I don't have the pay-per-view capabilities. Well, there's another way, especially if you're one of those Dish or D-Scrambler owners. You know who I'm talking about there. Ones of you out there who've got that.
Minute,
hey, Freddie Blassie.
How are you, Monsoon?
You look like you might have one of those Dish or D-Scramblers in your backyard.
Listen, this pencil neck geek you're sitting next to, he might not even be up to come up to the Survivor Series.
Hey, pal.
Sit down,
this
you
cheap
pencil neck
guy right here?
That cheapskate, that's El Cheapo. This
what?
Guy, he don't even want to exhale, figuring he's going to give somebody something for nothing.
Buddy, we're pals.
The day he was born, his father, he's such a disappointment, his father gave out cigar butts. You're my pal. Puy on you.
How much does he owe you, Freddy?
$65.
$65.
I sent you that in the mail.
You sent nothing to me in the mail, you pencil neck.
Well, I'll check with my office about
you'll
that.
You'll check nothing. You got no office. Your office is in your back pocket. Give me my money, you pencil neck.
Well, I just gave a $100 bill to a cab driver.
You gave $100 what?
to the limo driver.
Why are you penciling that geek? You never had $100 in your pocket.
All my other stuff's back in the room. I'll get it to you, though.
Yeah.
Let's go to the next match.
Yeah, sure.
We're not going anywhere right now. I'll collect it for you.
Will you? All right, Gino. Monsoon, I tell you, you're my friend. That penciling, yeah. I can't understand how you can sit next to this guy to hold.
Well, it's a contractual agreement. I have to do it.
I feel sorry for you and Roddy.
Monsoon, give him the money. I'll take care of you later.
You'll never get your money. Just like, your clothes are in the locker, right?
Uh-oh.
I'll be seeing you, you
couple. Freddie.
Hey, wait a minute. Fred.
Wait, what?
Wait, I'll make sure you get it.
He's going to look funny going on a plane with a sequin jacket, Boney.
He looks funny no matter where he goes, whatever he's wearing.
Oh, wait a minute. What's going on here? Piper can be over there by himself. He walks out here and says, I owe him some money I don't know anything about.
About the pictures that you took down off the wall? I know. And you broke Pencil Neck Geek, the record.
It wasn't me that did it. I know who did it.
Sure.
Me?
He wasn't even over there.
Sure. Now you say that.
They told me who was there. You Pencil Neck Geek, you.
See, it all comes out in the end.
$65. For $65, you ruin your reputation, you bum, you.
No, it didn't cost him near that much, Freddie, to ruin his reputation. He doesn't have one. It stinks.
You're right, Monsoon.
Thanks for dropping by, and I'll see that you get your money.
Remember what I said. He might not survive until the Survivor Series.
Well, that could happen too, you know. You make an enemy of that man right there, you're in deep trouble. And obviously, you made an enemy.
Just because he didn't get his Medicare check in the mail, he'll have to pick on me.
Matchup headed our way right now. Let's take a look at the big African Dream Akeem.
This contest is scheduled for one ball.
Capacity crowd on hand here in Wheeling, West Virginia. As Paul Roma makes his way to the ring, and they are really lined in here in Wheeling, Alfred, for the WWF. And Paul Roma's a fine athlete.
He really is. What a fine athlete. You're absolutely right. He has that tremendous leaping ability, and he is the possessor of the most devastating dropkick in the World Wrestling Federation.
And his opponent.
And he is going to have all these tools with him in this match. Look who's coming to the ring.
Styles, Mick, from deepest, darkest Africa, weighing 457.
What a gigantic man. Akeem against Paul Roma. Should be a good match.
And he's oozing confidence. Look at him.
You're right. Paul Roma waiting for Akeem to get in the ring now for the Survivor Series. What a great team when you put Akeem, the Big Boss Man, Rick Martel, and the Honky Tonk Man all on one team to go up against the Dream Team made up of Dusty Rhodes, the Captain, Brutus the Barber, Beefcake, Tito Santana, and the Red Rooster. A lot of implications there.
Yes, and the team that Akeem is in, the Enforcers, with the Big Boss Man as the Captain, they are a powerful, powerful, awesome team. And of course, they go in with Honky Tonk Man and Rick Martel. Tremendous combination.
Alfred, you were talking about confidence, and you can just see it right now on Akeem as he goes in against Roma, who really is very wary of Akeem. Look at Paul Roma. I've never seen Paul so tentative.
Yes, he's very cautious, and he has good reason to be. Akeem recently has been showing tremendous form. I haven't seen him lose a match yet. He's doing so well.
Using his quickness that time, Roma stepped out of the way, looking over towards the Slickster, who certainly can get involved in a match. And I would think that in the Survivor Series, Slickster and the Colonel, Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart, can be at ringside for the Enforcer. So in effect, Alfred, you could have six men there at ringside or in the ring against the Dream Team.
You could indeed. You know, and if you look at Akeem, 450 pounds, very fleet, very mobile on his feet, he could possibly take on the other team by himself and still be the survivor in that Thanksgiving night tradition.
That time he moved out of the way, and Roma got his hits in, Alfred, and then moves back. Little hit and run tactic here.
Oh, fantastic. Obviously got a great game plan. And look at Slick, he doesn't approve of those methods, treating his man like that.
We talked about Roma being cautious. Leapfrog over the big man, the quickness of Paul Roma. Right hands again, this time up against the shoulder of Akeem. And notice, those are great shots that Roma's giving Akeem, but it's not having that much of an effect.
Not really, that didn't faze the big man at all. Roma shot in about four right-handers there. It would have floored a normal man, but certainly not this huge Goliath, Akeem.
The counter and elbow tie up now. Sending Roma back to the right side. Akeem with a definite weight advantage. One blow softens up Roma a little bit into the ropes, missing a clothesline again. Here comes Roma trying the big splash over the rope, but no, Akeem caught him in midair and puts him back down. The power of Akeem, and you talked about it, Alfred, how it's going to come into play during the Survivor Series.
The big man, and certainly he can play a big factor in that match, pitting the Enforcers against the Dream Team.
Definitely, you can well imagine the Dream Team are watching this. Dusty Rhodes, Brutus Beefcake, Tito Santana, and Red Rooster, and definitely taking stock of what is taking
place
here. And
you're going to find out what happened to a smart Eddie. Hey, pretty boy.
The words from the slickster at ringside, a little intimidation to Paul Roma. Now Akeem will just send Roma to the near side, right to the floor.
How frustrating that must be for Roma, those tremendous right-hand blows to Akeem, and didn't faze him.
Back in he goes with a kick, right hands to the side of the head. Again, Paul Roma with a drop kick. Still cannot get the big man off his feet, for goodness sakes, and he goes right at him again. That does not discourage Paul Roma. He'll send him into the other corner. No, sir. Akeem just took one step to the right, and Paul Roma hit flush. Here comes Akeem. Oh, my goodness. A gigantic clothesline. Here we go. The big splash. Regardless of what type of athlete you are, you can't survive that. Let's get the official word.
Akeem there, a tremendous victory for him, and this man can be so dangerous in the ring. And you can see how dangerous it is if we look at what happened a little moment ago. And let us see this. Watch how Akeem goes in now. A dangerous, deceptive turn of speed there by Akeem, sidestepping Roma, and Roma goes down. And Akeem absolutely ready to take full advantage of that tremendous, powerful clothesline. And I'm afraid that's all she wrote for Paul Roma.
Finish it up with the gigantic splash. Your winner, Akeem. Now let's go back to the primetime studio. Gorilla Monsoon, Rowdy Roddy Piper, and Bobby the Brain Heenan.
The African Dream, Akeem, will certainly be a force to reckon with in Survivor Series as he joins a team of the Enforcers. And I understand that the fashion plate is still with us.
You come to my studio, Mr. Freddie Blassie, the classy Mr. Freddie.
He's over in Studio B.
We got over here. Excuse me, Studio I. Gurr, we got classy Freddie Blassie. You are welcome in my studio anytime. One of the greatest managers ever. You got a buck there. You got a dollar bill.
Yeah, that's all I could get out of his pocket. That's all he had.
How did you get the dollar bill?
I went into his locker and went through his clothes.
You know how to get into his locker room?
I certainly do.
You got a key to his locker room?
I have.
Well, I have. What's wrong,
Gordon? I have valuables in there.
$1. That's about 50 cents more than I thought you had.
I have $22,000 in my pocket in those pants.
How much did you have?
$22,000.
He had holes in his pocket. That's all he's got in his pocket.
Well, I've been robbed then. I've been ripped off.
I have a question. This is classic. No pun intended. I have a question. You are one of the greatest managers ever in the WWF. If you were to take all the managers, now let's eliminate all of it. Let's just talk about the manager that is in the WWF now, Bobby. We call him Boobsy. He loves that name.
Boobsy.
Just try it. Go, Boobsy.
Boobsy.
There you go. How would you rate Boobsy from 1 to 10? Do you need more numbers? Okay, from negative 5 to 10, how would you rate Boobs? We're talking negative 10 to 10. When you take a man, let's say he takes a man like Rick Rude, and Rick Rude, just before he's going to have the Intercontinental title, he gets him into a beef. Would you do that with one of your men?
No, sir.
Boobs, are you listening? You're listening to a man here of knowledge. No, quit sucking your thumb. You're listening to a man of talent, Boobs.
This is my show. I didn't play last night.
You didn't.
No. Hey, he needs $65 that bad. I'll make sure you get it.
Mr. Blassie, that you'll ever see that $64 additional. We'll be right back with more.
I'm going to get the authority on this. My money's...
Yes, Grandma Heenan. I know he doesn't like to be called Boobsy. I won't call him that anymore. I I know someday he'll grow up to be just like you, but the phone never rings. You know, no, wait, one second. You know, now that we've had a chance to know that we've got Tito Santana going against, who's Tito Santana going against? Big Boss Man. Thank you very much, Gorilla. Against the Big Boss Man, we have a second match that is second to none from the forecourt. We're going to have Hercules going against Macho, now let me get this straight. Macho Man King Randy Savage, that's a queen. Oh, no, no, no. With the queen, Sherry. Now we're going to have that all on the same show. We're talking the hottest doggone show. We're talking Hot Rod here. Hottest show you've ever... Pardon, Grandma? I'm sorry. Bobby? Bobby?
Oh, I've just about had enough.
Oh, you're leaving.
He brings on an 85-year-old octogenarian that's down on his luck and is trying to put the bite on me for $65. He's got a rubber mask, a banana phone over there, and a pumpkin.
Sure, the guy's left now.
Hey, I'll knock them both out if they come over here. I want to talk about something important, where I'm going to be, the Survivor Series.
Okay.
Go ahead. You got the floor. Tell us where you're going to be. Go ahead.
Go ahead. Bob?
Time is yours.
Okay.
Do it.
Go.
We haven't got time. We're going to go to the ringside right now. Take a look at Hercules.
Following contest is
certainly one of the strongest men in the World Wrestling Federation, the mighty Hercules, set to go up against George South. We are in Toledo, Ohio. What a response for the mighty Hercules, Lord Alfred Hayes.
Indeed, everybody loves him, and they love what he represents. A powerful man who's a straight man, an honest-to-goodness wrestler.
The mighty Hercules, George South, set to square off. The mighty Hercules, certainly involved in the Survivor Series, on the 4x4 team, captained by Hacksaw Jim Duggan. Rugged Ronnie Garvin's on that team, along with the Hitman Bret Hart, against King's Court, the Macho King, Greg the Hammer Valentine, Nita Bravo, and the Widowmaker. And I think of all the matchups in the Survivor Series, the King's Court against the 4x4, what an intriguing matchup that is.
You know, you took the word right out of my mouth that I was going to say intriguing, but it's also very electrifying. What competitors in both teams. Bret the Hitman Hart with Hercules, who you see in the ring now, and Ronnie Garvin, and the captain, the most charismatic of all, Hacksaw Jim Duggan. What a team.
The tie-up, and immediately Hercules goes to a side headlock. When you break the teams apart, Alfred, and you think about, well, Hacksaw Jim Duggan certainly has... more than a score to settle with the Macho King and the Sensational Queen. Rugged Ronnie Garvin has one with Greg Valentine. Hercules and Dino Bravo, what a matchup that could be. And that's just breaking them down individually. Of course, it's going to be a 4-on-4 Survivor-type match.
Yes, and don't forget, with Bravo, Valentine, and the Macho King, there is Widowmaker, and in my opinion, he's one of the most forceful men there is in the World Wrestling Federation.
George South getting some blows in, right to the trapezius of... the mighty Hercules missing a clothesline. What in the world was George South doing? He was looking north, and it was Hercules coming from the south side with a clothesline from behind. Why in the world would you take your attention away from a guy like Hercules?
I really don't know. I can't understand South doing that. I wouldn't say inexperienced because he's not inexperienced. He's a great wrestler.
Face first, now to the turnbuckle. The fans here in Toledo counting right along with the mighty Hercules. George South swinging a ghost as he goes down face first.
I like that look on Hercules' face there. He more or less said, what on earth has happened to this fellow?
Oh, South came up with a headbutt. Nicely done. Drop kick. It staggered Hercules back to the corner. But no, a wild right hand missed the mark. George South again looking the other way. Hercules with a big clothesline. And down goes George South.
I'm afraid South has underestimated his opponent here. He hasn't done his homework on Hercules. Hercules is a powerful, powerful man.
Sending South out. You're right, Alfred, a powerful man, and the type of man who would be very successful and probably will be in a match, a 4-on-4 match, where if you're pinned or you submit disqualified, you have to go back to the dressing room, such as the Survivor Series, a man who I think would do quite well.
And isn't he showing up well here today? Look at this, way he's handled George South. Those blows don't really mean a thing to Hercules.
So South trying to take the shortcut. He's trying to choke hold there. It did not work. Sending Hercules in. Hercules goes in. George South follows in. But Hercules had moved. So George South finds himself all tied up.
And I like that about Hercules, too, taking his time, not rushing into anything, measuring his man.
Going right to the midsection, right to the throat. Following George wants a tag. for goodness sakes. And here's the big slam.
Hercules still taking his time, and that is the hallmark of a great wrestler. When you've got your man on the run, take your time.
The elbow drop, the mighty Hercules. Evidently prepared to end this match, as he has completely dominated George South, especially within the last few moments. Picks him up, vertical suplex, possibly right here. Has him up nicely, kicks the legs, good, good. Suplex that time for the mighty Hercules. And now here we go.
Two great things in that suplex. One was timing, and the other one was power.
You're right, Alfred, both of them right on that suplex. And now, with the backbreaker, George South submits. A tremendous win. Let's get the official word.
Here is your winner, the mighty Hercules.
Well, Alfred, for the Survivor Series, I would want Hercules on my team.
And certainly, and I'm sure that Hacksaw Jim Duggan, Brent the Hitman Hart, Ronnie Garvin were watching their comrade there, the other member of their team. What a great team for that Thanksgiving night tradition.
All right, your winner, the mighty Hercules. Let's now go back to our primetime studios.
Well, I certainly wouldn't be upset about having Hercules on my team, I'll tell you that.
He's a big, powerful man. He just can't think.
Can't think.
You've noticed
he's
that,
he's thinking
too.
A lot better since he left the Heenan family. I noticed that right off the bat.
Think? Can I tell the people now where I'm going to be
go
this
ahead.
Week?
Floor is yours.
Friday night on the 27th, I'll be in Auburn Hills, Michigan at the Palace, my first time there.
Look out, Michigan.
Saturday night, 28th, I'll be in Madison Square Gardens, New York.
Big Apple, be careful.
Sunday night, I'll be in Toronto at the Maple Leaf Garden.
Why do you want to mention Toronto? Primetime doesn't air in Toronto.
No, but it airs in Buffalo, New York, and if the people aren't too cheap, they can get in their cars and only drive like 60, 70, 90 miles. I'm worth it.
That's only your biased opinion. You're worth it. Well, so far, we've named two of the big matches that will appear on our special Sunday, November 12th, Survivor Series Showdown right here on the USA Network. Hercules against the Macho King, Randy Savage, and, of course, the earlier match that we mentioned, Tito Santana against the Big Boss Man.
I know who's out of the Bobby Heenan family.
Here's a guy that's not in the Heenan family, Sean Mooney.
Hello, everyone. I'm Sean Mooney. The tension running high these days here in the World Wrestling Federation, it is going to get more and more tense as we draw nearer to the Survivor Series. It comes to you live from Chicago's Rosemont Horizon, November 23rd, and it's a pay-per-view spectacular you absolutely will not want to miss. Five spectacular elimination matches on the way. They include the Dream Team. Their captain is Dusty Rhodes. The Dream Team getting prepared to take on the Enforcers. They will be captained by the former prison guard, Big Boss Man. Also, it's Roddy's Rowdies, their captain, Roddy Piper, as his foursome gets set to take on the Rude Brood, their captain, Ravishing Rick Rude. The Ultimate Warriors, they will be captained by the Intercontinental Champion, the Ultimate Warrior, and he is more than ready, along with his team of four, to take on Heenan's family. The captain for that foursome is Andre, the Ultimate Giant. And listen to this, the Million Dollar Team, they will be captained by the Million Dollar Man, Ted DiBiase, the self-proclaimed million-dollar champion. They will face the Hulkamaniacs, and leading that foursome, the World Wrestling Federation champion, Hulk Hogan. Also, it's the 4x4s taking on the King's Court. And right now, the Macho King, Randy Savage, is standing by with more on this battle.
The King and his court, the Survivor Series. I couldn't be more proud of Dino Bravo, the Hammer, and the Widowmaker.
Yes.
You think Widowmaker?
You know the Hitman is gonna meet me. I'm gonna survive just like the rest of the King's Court.
That's right. The King's Court is the best team in the Survivor Series. And Rugged Ronnie Garvin, I'm going to get my chance to settle the score with you. That's right. I take a lot of pride, Macho King, to be part of this court, because we're going to do the job the right way. Hercules! The Survivor Series. Get ready, Hacksaw Jim Duggan, you're overmatched. The King and his court will survive.
Yeah.
Be a part of the Thanksgiving tradition and see the Survivor Series, Thursday, November 23rd, available on a pay-per-view basis. Call your local cable company for availability.
Do not miss your chance to be a part of World Wrestling Federation history, the Survivor Series, taking place live from the Rosemont Horizon in Chicago, November 23rd. Right now, it's time to feel the power of the WWF.
Wes McMahon.
eyes and ears of the world will be honed in on the Rosemont Horizon in Chicago Thanksgiving night for the Biggie Survivor Series. What are you looking for now?
You know what's in this bank?
Absolutely nothing if it's yours.
Zeus. That is DiBiase's money in the bank.
It is, huh?
That's right. And that's a guy Hogan don't want anything to do with.
You know what? I understand that DiBiase paid all those guys to go in there and be part of that team, that four-man team. But when it comes down to four against three or four against two or four against one, be a different story. Here's the Hulkster.
I think we're made pretty clear as far as the Hulkster is concerned. What a matchup this is going to be, Jesse.
It's going to be a great matchup. As you said, McMahon, you got the technology and the wrestling ability of the million-dollar man. Plus, he's got that 6'9" or 6'10" insurance policy sitting outside the ring. I would say Hogan's maybe in big jeopardy of losing his title.
I'll agree with you, but one thing the Hulkster has on his side is millions of Hulkamaniacs, and there's a capacity crowd right here witnessing what's about to happen. Listen to the Hulkamaniacs, listen to them.
But the Hulkamaniacs can't get into the ring, McMahon. They can yell and scream all they want, and they can listen as the Hulkster goes from one rope to the other and gets his pat on the back from them. But still,
but DiBiase just says, he gestures, yeah, but money can buy Zeus. A warning here by the Hulkster. Zeus better stay in his corner and better stay out of the matchup. Zeus has been a thorn in Hulk Hogan's side ever since the filming of No Holds Barred.
Well, the thing that Hogan's going to have to do, McMahon, he's going to have to concentrate on the million-dollar man, Ted DiBiase. He cannot let Zeus distract him in the ring.
Ted DiBiase, circling, ready to lock up with the Hulkster. A million-dollar match, indeed a tremendous opportunity for DiBiase. Hulkster asserting his strength, backing Ted DiBiase to the corner. Reversal here. Wait a minute, Zeus has the angle. Zeus has the angle of the Hulkster. They're starting right from the top of this match.
Did you expect anything less, McMahon?
Hulk has no pressure to run a jeopardy here, but the Hulkster right now, pummeling DiBiase. The rope, a big roundhouse like Simpson down in a canvas. And it looks like Hulk is continuing to be distracted by Zeus.
Ha-ha, it appears to me that DiBiase's plan might be working, McMahon.
The Hulkster now with a wrenching, standing headlock on the million-dollar man. Grinding it out, referee warning Zeus. Stay in your corner. To the ropes goes the Hulkster, shoulder blocking DiBiase down. Hulkster, 300-plus pounds, ducking DiBiase down here with just a minute. Zeus and Hulk. The referee comes in, and so does DiBiase.
And there's no way the ref can make a call there because by the time he saw it, they both had each other, so there was no way to determine who made first contact, McMahon.
Hulkster off the rope. DiBiase missing with the Hulkster connecting. Series of one-off runs, and DiBiase continues to reel. Hulk now with DiBiase, whips him to the buckle and comes right in with a vicious elbow. And DiBiase down.
He caught the million-dollar man with that elbow right to the sternum, driving the wind out of the million-dollar man.
Whoa, look at this. Hulk blatantly hammering into the forehead of DiBiase, being warned by the official who has to pull the hair of Hulk Hogan.
That's good. It's about time we get a hands-on official in a Hogan match.
From behind, DiBiase wrecking the face of Hulk Hogan. DiBiase now in control. Setting the Hulkster up, levels him with a clothesline. Over by Zeus, again, a great choke hold from our vantage point as DiBiase distracts the official.
Isn't it a brilliant move by the million-dollar man? He's got referee Dave Hebner tied up in the ring. Zeus is doing the damage, choking the wind out of Hulk Hogan. What's going on here now?
Wait, here comes Jake the Snake Roberts. We're going to even the score here a bit. Jake the Snake with an accusing finger pointed at Zeus a moment ago. DiBiase continuing to hammer into the Hulkster's head. What a Wild West matchup we have here. Well, and now DiBiase spots Jake the Snake, his nemesis, for the first time.
You can hear DiBiase yelling, you got no business out here.
Indeed he does. A roll-up $1 million man put on him.
Elbow misses by DiBiase. Another attempt, another miss. Hulk back to his feet now. Warning DiBiase, moving in. A Brock punch. Oh, hard right. Another hard right. Jake the Snake looking over at Seuss as the Hulkster continues to hammer away on the $1 million man. Now, from up above, Hulk Hogan leveling the hammer.
You know, to me, Hogan's the devious one.
Virgil, the bodyguard of the $1 million man, just grabbed Jake the Snake. Snake Damien. Snake is right behind him, chasing him. The Hulkster's looking on. Ted DiBiase gets up ahead of Steve, leveling Hulk Hogan to the outside of the ring. The Hulkster's hurt. He's on the outside. We'll sort it all out and be right back.
So the Snake's out. They got the Snake out. First thing that happens, Hogan turns his back. Boom, DiBiase gives him a cheap shot. You can't call it a cheap shot in wrestling. You gotta take what you get. Hogan's there. Next thing I see is the one-eyed purple people eater. He turned around. He coming after Hogan. Never know what he's gonna do because Zeus himself, he don't know what he's doing. He taking orders from somebody else. But that ain't nothing. You ought to see what Jake gonna do with that Snake when he catches Virgil. We'll be right back. Get into this match now.
Back with more Saturday Night's Main Event, the Hulkster back into the ring, and the $1 million man continuing to hammer away. And Zeus perhaps sensing victory on the outside. And indeed, Ted DiBiase getting closer and closer to wearing the World Wrestling Federation Championship.
Well, not only did Ted DiBiase have an insurance policy in Zeus, but we all seem to have forgotten about Virgil, didn't we?
Indeed, it's a cover one, two. DiBiase wearing the Hulkster now, but it hasn't been just a one-on-one attempt, obviously. There's been a double-team effort going on here.
Well, DiBiase doesn't care how he gets the title. I mean, let's face it, the man's not exactly ethical when it comes to getting what he wants, but results are what counts. Beautiful textbook suplex right there.
DiBiase with another cover. This could do it. He hooks the leg to it. Good, almost a count of three. Ted DiBiase getting closer and closer to his quest. DiBiase now up on the top rope. Waiting, measuring the Hulkster. The Hulkster crumbling down to the canvas once again.
He caught him with the
and
elbow.
Another cover, hooks the leg, and still only a count of two. Unbelievable resilience on the part of the Hulkster.
And DiBiase very smart there, McMahon. He goes in to a hold that's gonna wear Hogan down. Obviously, Hogan not ready to be pinned yet. DiBiase with the smarts goes to a wear-down hold. Gonna take its toll on him. And look at the face of the insurance policy outside the ring.
Hulkster back to his feet. Trying to escape the hold. His capacity crowd going nuts. The Hulkster grabbing the elbow for the third time. Breaks the hold. Hits the rope. Shoulder block by Hulk Hogan. Two ropes again over DiBiase from the far side.
Double clothesline. Both men go down. They both have the same thing on their mind right there. Each man going for the clothesline. Now we got a race as referee Dave Hepner counts.
DiBiase and Hulk Hogan both on the canvas, but the Hulkster pops up first. Hulkster calling over. Now back to his feet. Dazed. And now we'll hit the ropes. Oh, look at that. Hitting the ropes to now DiBiase and Zeus hammering into the back of Hulk Hogan. Don't cover him now.
Wasn't that a dumb move by Hogan?
Oh, my. DiBiase on target with the right hand from high above. Measures the Hulkster again.
And DiBiase with the clear advantage here. And it looks like he's going out. And it looks like he's going to the top, McMahon. If he hits something here, high-risk move, we can have a new $1 million champion.
Drops the knee to the chest as DiBiase, and yes, a new champion to be known. Hulkster checking out, and this time I think he means business. DiBiase frustrated, hammering away. His punches have no effect. Again, Hulkster just shaking his head no. Hulk Hogan getting himself out.
Look at the face of Ted DiBiase. He can't believe it.
Hulk Hogan moving in. Money can't buy it, DiBiase. You're going to have to earn it. Hogan hammering away into Ted DiBiase. Boxing to the ropes. Sets him up from the far side. Oh, tremendous kick.
turns the tide of this match now.
Wait a minute. Here comes Zeus. Zeus, a human wrecking machine from behind. Hook first are preventing the right hand from landing. Hulk Hogan hooked by the mighty Zeus.
And you know he ain't going nowhere.
DiBiase. Zeus will go down. Small package. Hulkster hooks him and gets the
three. Oh, I can't believe it. He's locked out again. He has got to be the luckiest wrestler on the face of this earth, McMahon.
Wait a minute. Right now, what we all have waited for. A one-on-one encounter is about to happen. Hulk, one-on-one with Zeus, the human wrecking machine. We've been waiting for this for a long, long time. Hulkster and Zeus circling. This is an unofficial matchup. And it's just about all ready to break loose now. The powerful Zeus ready to assert himself again. No, DiBiase from behind.
Break his neck. Did you hear that? Ted DiBiase telling Zeus break his neck.
Zeus wrenching the neck of Hulk Hogan. The Hulkster falling right down to the canvas. Some sort of reverse chin lock there just wrenched his neck.
And how easy he did that, McMahon. It was like nothing for Zeus.
Hulk Hogan barely to his feet. I can't believe what DiBiase just did to the official. And now, DiBiase applying the million-dollar dream to the Hulkster. He's wearing him right
down. He's down to one knee. It's going to be off to dreamland for Hogan. Never before has Hogan been put to sleep. But I think we're going to have a first here, McMahon, on Saturday night's main event. The Hulkster going off to dreamland. I wonder if he's going to have nightmares about Zeus.
Zeus wrenches his neck. Wait a minute. Here's Jake the Snake coming back in. Damian is loose in the ring. DiBiase heading for cover. Jake the Snake with Damian loose in the ring breaks things up. But unfortunately for Hulk Hogan, he has suffered the consequences. The Hulkster's still down. He won the match. He won the battle. But I'm not too sure if he won the war.
Just adding more fuel to the fire. One more score to be settled in Survivor Series.
Last time I saw Hogan, he was laying flat.
Yeah, why? You saw why.
DiBiase put him out.
Yeah, without any help.
Right? Zeus whipped his neck around.
Some interference from the
outside.
He's
still laid out.
Sure.
Doesn't matter if
take a guy and blindside him with a 4x4, he'd be laid out too.
Doesn't matter. He's out. That's what we're dealing with, knocking him out. The guy's hit by a Volkswagen or a Greyhound. He's out.
Who's wearing the gold, Heenan?
Hogan. Right now. And you know his days are numbered.
His days are numbered.
Sure. Can't go on forever.
You ought to know about that. Anybody that's a champion that's ever been a champion in the Heenan family, their days are numbered, aren't they? Well, you don't want to discuss that, do you?
Well, I'll discuss anything you want.
Sure.
I care to talk about that with you, though.
89 was going to be the year of the brain. Well, it started out the year of the brain, wasn't it?
Roll
and
it.
Ended up the year of the brain tumor, perhaps. Right now, let's go to Sean Mooney, who doesn't have a tumor.
Who is this guy?
After what we just saw between Hulk Hogan and the Million Dollar Man Ted DiBiase, I would say it is certain this battle will carry over into the Survivor Series, coming your way live from Chicago, November 23rd. Right now, standing by, let's get opposing views from both the Million Dollar Team and the Hulkamaniacs.
Hulk Hogan, you've finally gotten a taste of what the money of the Million Dollar Man can do. Just a week ago at Saturday night's main event, Zeus and I left you laid in the ring. An unconscious heap of flesh. How do you think you're going to survive the Survivor Series when you couldn't even survive Saturday night's main event? Demolition, look at what I have for you. The powers of pain, and I have paid them so well, they'll march right through you. And you, Jake the Snake Roberts, I'm going to give you a one-way ticket right back to that hospital that I sent you to. And that'll leave you again, Hogan, standing in the middle of the ring all by yourself to face the entire million-dollar team. And you will truly find out what my money can do.
Yeah! Yeah!
1 week ago, multi-million dollar man, me and all my Hulkamaniacs survived one of your greatest financial moves, brother. With that big investment in that bounty hunter Zeus in your corner, you figured for sure you'd be guaranteed a victory over me and Hulkamania. Well, you can't buy me off, brother. You can't buy the Hulkamaniacs off. And this is the Survivor Series. There's no way you'll be able to pay anybody off on our team. You speculate about eliminating us one by one, hopefully saving me for last so you can tear Hulkamania apart. It'll never happen, brother. These guys are Hulkamaniacs. Demolition, Snake Man, and Damien, you'll never leave my side.
Bottom line is this, DiBiase. What your men are doing for money, we are doing for the cold, sheer pleasure of it.
Ted DiBiase, you got a couple of bad dudes. Well, we know about the powers of pain. Jake knows about Ted DiBiase, and Hulk Hogan knows about Zeus.
Hulkamaniacs, they protect each other. They're trustworthy. They're dependable. And we're behind you 200%.
You know something, Ted DiBiase? Think about it, brother. Survivor Series, man. As soon as your money goes down the tubes, these guys are going to leave you alone. What are you going to do if it's us four against you, DiBiase?
Be a part of the Thanksgiving tradition and see the Survivor Series. Thursday, November 23rd, available on a pay-per-view basis. Call your local cable company for availability.
Things heating up indeed for the big 10 teams in the Survivor Series that'll all go down Thanksgiving night in Chicago at the Horizon.
Rosemont Horizon.
Well,
I'll be there.
You know, the macho king, Randy Savage, the captain of King's Court. Obviously, here's a man of great character, a man of great ability who was the WWF champion, Intercontinental champion. He's obviously seen something very strong and powerful in a certain individual that we're going to be taking a look at in just a moment, referring to the Widowmaker.
Tough cookie.
Just take a look at this guy.
One of the biggest and baddest in the World Wrestling Federation, Lord Alfred Hayes.
In the ring to the
Widowmaker, the big man from Texas.
He is a big man indeed.
A very, very impressive man who's impressed everybody who's come against him.
And his opponent from Sweetwater, Texas.
From Sweetwater, Texas, as you hear the announcement. Not only that big and bad, but here's a man who has been chosen to be part of King's Court during the Survivor Series. The Widowmaker to go up against Jim McPherson, but here's some pre-recorded comments from the Widowmaker.
The Widowmaker, along with the world's strongest man, Dino Bravo, the Hammer Valentine, and the Macho King, Randy Savage, will dominate in the Survivor Series because the King's Court is going to take it all the way to the top.
Pretty good team, I would say, wouldn't you?
I'd say an excellent team. If you watch the Widowmaker carefully, he looks almost casual in his approach, but don't let that fool you for one moment. He is absolutely all business, power, and precision inside the ring.
And a big hip toss sending McPherson down, certainly much larger than Jim McPherson. And together with the Macho King, Dino Bravo, and Greg the Hammer Valentine, it's going to be quite a confrontation when they go up against the 4x4s in the Survivor Series. And don't forget that 4-on-4 confrontation here in Survivor Series means if you're pinned, if you get disqualified, or if you submit, then you got to go to the dressing room. You could have a 4-on-1 if it's all over.
That's absolutely possible. And looking at the Widowmaker, you would believe that he could take on four men anyway.
Picks up McPherson after assaulting McPherson into the corner, handling McPherson easily, and now with the reverse atomic drop, nicely done.
McPherson, a big man at 6'3", very heavily built man, and yet look at the size of him against the Widowmaker. Widowmaker, 6'8", 6'9", tremendously powerful wrestler.
Seemingly at will, taking charge of McPherson with a gigantic vertical suplex.
And using every inch of that height to get maximum effect against Johnson. I would say that Valentine Bravo and the Macho King are watching him right now.
Pulling now right on the face, I think so. Not only that, Hacksaw Jim Duggan's team's watching him also.
And not exactly with the same thoughts in mind.
No, not at all. Right hand, boy, really nailing that time. Send McPherson down, and sent him down in such a way that he even bounced back up off of the mat. For goodness sakes.
But he has a contemptuous grin on his face all the time. He knows when he's in command. He's handling this man like a baby.
After McPherson once again. picking up McPherson, and this may be the beginning of the end. Yes, it looks like a superplex. One more right hand. McPherson appears to be out, even though he's in a sitting position, as the Widowmaker looks out to the fans and goes down with a gigantic superplex over the top. And yes, the Widowmaker.
Here is your winner, the Widowmaker.
Tony, there was never any question of doubt about the result of this match. The Widowmaker controlled it all the way through, and I'm sure King's Court colleagues were all watching this tremendous performance by the Widowmaker.
And now back to Bobby the Brain Heenan, Gorilla Monsoon, and Rowdy Roddy Piper in the Primetime Studios.
Obviously destined to be a dominating force here in the World Wrestling Federation, Widowmaker. Studio B, what's on your mind?
Well, I got a question. First of all, did I hear, Boobs, that you're going to be in Auburn Hills?
That's what he said, yes.
At the Palace? Yes.
Well, how's about that being the buddies we are? I'm going to be there, too.
Aren't you lucky?
And there's one more thing. I have one more fight that is very important to me that I want to. It's in Glens Falls, and it's on the 28th. And there's a lady that has more guts than any professional wrestler that I have ever met. Her name is Elizabeth Morgan. Any lady on the protection of her daughter that'll do 20 months in jail, I gotta give my salute to, and an honorable primetime salute, because there is a true mom, and we're proud to just talk about you, and I want to dedicate my fight in Glens Falls to you, ma'am, because I think you're one heck of a good woman. That's all
I'm gonna
I
have
say.
To agree with him on that.
Uh-oh, we're in trouble.
He went to jail for 20 months and wouldn't talk. Any woman that can keep her mouth shut for 20 months deserves something.
Will you stop?
Should have laid a charge card on her. She'd have talked.
Yeah, if you haven't like gotten out and bought your Halloween candy yet, right now may be a good time to do just that, because coming up right here on Primetime Wrestling.
Wouldn't hurt a little rubber hose either.
Not one of my favorite
can make them crack.
People.
Oh. What a horrible close-up.
Thank you. My guest this week is number one on the Big Boss Man's hurt list. He will soon be living a nightmare. He is America.
Like that, Jesse. That's true, McMahon. I can't. He's just a common man. Working on the Boss Man's Billy Club living. Boss Man's handcuffs.
There, Brother Dream. Yes. Not. What is it that you're looking for there, Brother Dream?
I'm looking for that justice and hard times that the Boss Man was gonna lay on me.
Well, I tell you, you don't have to look too far, because the Big Boss Man will bring his justice right to you, Brother Dream.
Well, let me tell you what, Brother Love. Boss Man is slick, that jive-talking melon farmer. Got to understand that I hold the justice. I hold the cuffs. And I hold the end to the Big Boss Man, because I will survive.
Well, just a minute, Brother Dream. Let's talk about survival. Let's talk about Survivor Series, because you will be looking right across the ring from the Big Boss Man at Survivor Series. You're going to be looking at the enforcers, the Big Boss Man, King, yes, indeed. Brother Rick Martel and the Honky Tonk Man in Survivor Series.
Whoa. You ain't said nothing about the Dream Team. You know, we got that Red Rooster, and he's poultry in motion, cock-a-doodle-doo. And that Tito's antenna is faster than a bolt of light. And that Brutus the Barber, well, speaking of Brutus the Barber, Beefcake, you have had a haircut, haven't you, just recently? Yes, you have. And one other thing is the American dream. And Brother Love, if you get in my way, I will handcuff you and beat you about the head and shoulders with this club. And that's the bottom line, baby. Yeah!
All right, the American dream, Dusty Rhodes. Looking forward to an encounter with a big boss man. And if he doesn't have it before, he's likely to have it. Thanksgiving night. It's a Thanksgiving night tradition. All right, let's get down.
The Survivor Series, one of the premier World Wrestling Federation events, heads your way on Thanksgiving night. It's a Thanksgiving night tradition. Don't miss the Survivor Series.
And for all you folks who can't get to Chicago or don't have that pay-per-view capability, especially you Dish and D-Scrambler owners out there, I got a special message for you right now. Here's how you can partake. Just call Primetime 24 at 1-212-599-4445 and order the WWF Survivor Series. You don't want to be left out.
And for all you deadbeats that
big Dish out there, get it.
For all you deadbeats that don't have a TV, if you'd have paid your bills, you'd have had a TV.
Oh, will you stop? Once more, let me reiterate and remind you, Sunday, November 12th, the big one, coming up right here on Primetime Wrestling, Survivor Series Showdown. We've given you two matches, Santana against the Big Boss Man and Hercules against the Macho King. And next week, we're going to give you three more big matches. But talk about guys that are big here at the WWF. Let's talk about Jimmy Snuka, one of your team members.
You want to talk about Jimmy Snuka? Here's a fella that nobody has ever been able to figure out. Here's a guy that knows no pain. He don't like me. When I refer to him as Mr. Snuka. But one thing about him, he's roaring force. He goes straight ahead. And you want to know why? Just check it out. My team member.
Fans to their feet for the Superfly Jimmy Snuka. And we are in Toledo, Ohio with a cement. The Superfly to go up against the Brooklyn Brawler. What a response, Lord Albert Hayes, for the Superfly.
And this man certainly has his work cut out for him here against the Brooklyn Brawler. But the Superfly so far has been equal to any task that he's come up against.
Two different wrestlers all together when you talk about, as you see, a Superfly fan. You talk about the strategy and ability of the Superfly compared to that of the Brooklyn Brawler. And it seems that the Superfly is ready to go. And I would bet that the thoughts of Survivor Series creeping into his mind, because he's a part of Roddy's Rowdies, along with Roddy Piper, of course, the captain, and the Bushwhackers.
And what opposition they face on that Thanksgiving night tradition. They're going against Rude's Brood. And of course, the captain there is Rick Rude himself. And what a team he's got with him. Mr. Perfect and the fabulous Rougeos, Jack and Raymond.
Little shoving match right there as the fans get right behind the Superfly Jimmy Snuka. You know, ravishing Rick Rude, the captain of Rude's Brood. And of course, he's under the stable of the family of Bobby the Brain Heenan. But the Heenan family also has its team in there, led by Andre the Giant and, of course, Haku.
What a fantastic team that is. Don't forget, of course, they have the Brain Busters on their side as well. Heenan certainly knows how to pick his teams.
Double axe handle that time sent the Brooklyn Brawler down to the floor. The fans once again right behind the Superfly Jimmy Snuka.
And he's taken the initiative immediately in this match, taking his wall right against the Brooklyn Brawler.
Down on the floor, Alfred, there they go. Right hand, side of the head. The Brawler trying to get in some shots, but a block and a right hand by the Superfly. Big headbutt. And boy, that staggered the Brawler. Now look, he's trying to get away.
And what a mistake the Brawler made there, trying to mix it on the outside with Snuka. Snuka is up to any contingency whatsoever.
A stomp to the back. Picking Snuka up by the hair. The Brawler biting Snuka in the forehead. And I really don't think he wants to really get the Superfly any more fired up. Backpedaling goes the Superfly, moved out of the way. And the Brawler went in head first. As far as quickness goes, there's no comparison here.
Absolutely not. The Brawler was a little cautious coming in there, and he paid for it anyway. And look at the Superfly knife right on top of him.
Follows him in with a good clothesline. A rake to the eyes. Now the brawler trying maybe the short road here to get back. No, Superfly sends him in. Nicely done that time by the brawler. Over the top. Now this is where the Superfly excels. Look at this. Couple of leapfrogs. Chopped him right down.
Oh, that was really superb work there by the Superfly. He did exactly what he wanted to do with the brawler. Look at this.
Slams him down. The brawler still stunned from that backhanded chop. Apparently enabling the Superfly maybe here to take flight. Here he goes. The fans loving this. Here comes the Superfly. It's all over. The Superfly. Let's get the official word.
And Superfly there, he took the initiative right from the beginning, and he outclassed the Brooklyn Brawler every inch of the way. Let us see exactly how he finished the Brawler off. When he gets that look in his eye, he comes right down on top of his opponent there, and there was absolutely nothing the Brawler could do. A tremendous victory for the Superfly.
All right, a great win for Superfly. Jimmy Snuka, let's go back to the studio.
Superfly, obviously right at the top of his game and ready for Survivor Series.
Well, who's going to think on that team? Now, Perfect can
Captain,
think.
Captain, all right, the captain's right over there in Studio B. He's
Don't
a thinker.
Make me laugh. I'm going to manage Ravishing Rick Rude's team, Rick's Rude's Brood, and we're going to have
you can count them out right off the bat.
The Rougeos and Mr. Perfect. But who's going to think when he's got the Bushwhackers, two garbage men from New Zealand, himself?
I'm thinking about only one thing at this particular point in time. I'm thinking about next week because it's our annual Halloween special here on Primetime.
Last year I sat here and there was a guy in a gorilla suit for 2 hours. I thought it was you, then you walked out. I never found out who that was in the suit.
Well, Mr. Heenan?
I don't like tricks like
Hot
that.
Hot Rod, who are you going to be next week?
Well, what are you going to come as, Mr. Heenan? Oh, me? Personally?
Yeah,
I'm going to come.
Surprise us, maybe?
Or trick. I'm not going to tell you who I'm going to come as. I gotta think of just how I want to come. I got to think of just who I want to portray. And I'm going to think of somebody, and I'm going to have Mr. Heenan help me out. And when it's all done, I hope that Boobsy really enjoys it.
I'm sure he will. Feature match coming up in mere moments. We'll be right back after this.
Valentine, who's wobbly, dazed. He could drop at any moment. And he does. Face first.
Can't give those out till next week. Why? Because the contracts haven't been signed yet. The names have been drawn. We know what the pairings are, but the contracts, until they're signed, I can't tell the folks out there what the other three big matches will be on Sunday, November 12th.
Well, I know who's representing the Heenan family, but if you don't tell me, I'm not telling you who you know. Why
Feature
should I tell if you won't
right
tell?
Now for this edition
it's
of Prime Time Wrestling.
Like to tell, but if you want to tell Brutus, me, I'll
be glad to tell
you.
Brutus the Barber with some scores to settle.
No big deal.
He'll have his
you
hands
tell me,
full
I'll
with
tell
the
you.
Hammer.
You, wait a minute.
This contest is scheduled for one fall. Introducing to my left, managed by the Mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart. From Seattle, Washington, weighing 249 pounds, Greg the Hammer Valentine. And his opponent, from San Francisco, California, weighing 271 pounds, Brutus the Barber Beefcake.
What a response for Brutus the Barber Beefcake as he makes his way to the ring to do battle with Greg the Hammer Valentine. And there he is, the Barber. 271 pounds. Certainly one of the greatest stars in the World Wrestling Federation, Lord Alfred.
Indeed he is. If you had to measure charisma and appeal, this man would be right at the top of that measurement. Looks like he's had a slight ladder in his attire there. A couple of little holes.
Some runs?
Runs, yes.
Well, the Hammer was still part of him. And Greg Valentine knows Brutus the Barber Beefcake quite well. As well, he's down on the floor.
I tell you, it would be a nice sight to see some of those long, long golden locks of Greg the Hammer laying in the middle of the ring.
Speaking of haircuts, I know the mouth of the South, Jimmy Hart, knows all about Brutus the Barber's handiwork.
Yes. And many, many others who never, ever thought. A little pigtail there on Brutus.
It really is. That hair is starting to grow back after what had happened at the hands of Sensational Sherry and the Macho Man, Randy Savage.
I was going to say many others who never thought that the barber would be able to clip their locks did suffer the same fate.
Well, what a mug that is.
A surly look upon the face of Valentine.
Have a nice day, for goodness sake.
Yes.
Look at him. That is anything but a pleasant look.
But at the same time, Tony, that face didn't show any signs of conceding this match before it begins, even. I mean, that was quite a confident, although surly, look. And I would imagine that if 99% of wrestlers were standing in the corner the other side from the Hammer, that would be a little daunting to see a face with that surly look upon it. But not the barber. He is not the least bit. Look at that.
That bottom lip is really stuck out there. But the barber ready to do battle.
Yes, he doesn't care.
It appears at times that nothing really phases Brutus the Barber. The only thing that I can remember that's really gotten to him, of course, was the time they cut his hair, rightfully so.
Yes. He is a volatile young man, though. He does fly off the handle somewhat, and he's got to watch that temper against this person, because Valentine has got that fire that consumes from within inside, and he can control his temper to a degree, and he is a very, very rugged man. I really don't know what game plan Barber has in mind, but I would say, I really don't know what to say. It's very, very difficult. We know that the Barber is a very powerful wrestler, so I wouldn't say stay away from close physical contact. Maybe use that and try to be a little quicker to the draw each time.
The Hammer looking out to the thousands jammed here in the Nassau Coliseum. And so far the bell has sounded 2 minutes into it. The barber continues to size up Valentine for the old haircut.
Yes, he does indeed. That's a very mocking thing to do, isn't it? I mean, that's telling Valentine that he's won this match already, isn't
that's
it?
That's right. Telling the Hammer that when I pin you...
Yes, that's not if I pin you, that's when I pin you, isn't it?
That's right. This is how I want you to look.
Yes.
All right. The collar and elbow tie-up. A push back to a neutral corner. Valentine pushing in. Brutus giving way, and Valentine with a clean break, and I certainly didn't expect that. No one did.
No. No. He's obviously still thinking about this one. He's a little bit slow in the thinking department, Valentine. It takes him a little bit to get warmed up, and it takes him a long time to get warmed up physically. He is a rugged, tough, tough individual, though.
Well, I wouldn't want to go back to the corner for a second time with him, and that's what the barber's doing right now. Valentine, yep, a big shove. Brutus shoves back. Another shove. And this time he shoves the Hammer right down. Roundhouse right miss. A pickup. And maybe an atomic drop. Yes. Oh, Valentine is smarting. Big clothesline.
And what a nicely placed clothesline that was to the jaw of Valentine. The barber did risk Valentine ducking under that one, but he still stuck with it and nailed him right in the jaw.
The referee saying no, watch yourself here, but the barber paying more attention to the fans here. Oh, a big elbow. Regardless of what happens, he's gonna remember that one the rest of the night.
That was a nice elbow to the solar plexus there of Valentine, and Valentine's decided, and this is not often you see this, to head for the high ground. He really only knows one direction, and that's straight ahead. But this time, he really has backed off.
Valentine
breaks the count.
Certainly does.
Yeah, indeed, indeed. And that's another move. Well, what do you think is going through his head, Tony?
I don't know. Maybe it's dressing room time. You know, you're right. You hardly ever see Greg Valentine, with the exception of going straight ahead.
He doesn't back off to many, many people indeed. Now I suspect this is more of a ploy than actual backing off. In the beginning, he was definitely backing away from Brutus. Now a little ploy here, trying to lure Brutus into that corner. And of course, Beefcake having, nothing to do it wrong again.
Not a good move at all by the barber. Ran right into him. And now right to the solar plexus with some right hands. Really finding his mark. And the barber in trouble, just hanging onto that rope in the corner.
I don't know what the barber was thinking there. He didn't show much defense against those blows at all. That first boot to the chest or the sternum there must have caught him a really bad blow, because he's not thinking clearly at all now.
The referee warning the hammer, but no, the barber waiting on him. Beefcake with the right hands to Valentine, who's wobbly, dazed. He could drop at any moment, and he does, face first. Valentine still down. The barber hovers over him. Face first again.
My word, he sent Valentine crashing into the mat head first that time. Oh! I really did believe that was going to be a three count there, but once again, the hammer just managed to slither out of that. What was your interpretation of that, Tony?
I thought it was over, Alfred.
Ah. Well, he lives again.
The barber in to get him again. Right hand to the jaw. Brutus sending Valentine other side. Right to the turnbuckle. Valentine back onto the mat. Here's the cover. Doesn't hook a leg. And gets a two count. Valentine gets up the left shoulder.
And that was an easy out for Valentine then. And this is where, believe it or not, Valentine draws strength from. He'll take a tremendous pounding like this. And he just seems to get stronger and stronger the more it goes along. He's an incredible, incredible man. I don't know what it is. I've never been able to fathom it out, but he does. And I've had one or two matches against Valentine a few years ago, and I realized this man, he was a youngster then, had the potential that he's shown today.
Side of the head, Valentine, you're right. Drawing power, looks like even though he is backing up, he's trying to bring him into the corner with him. And seems to be well aware of what's going on here. There you go. He got him into the corner. Rolls the barber around. Now let's see what he can do offensively here. He'll send him to the other side. No, the barber reverses. Beefcake with a big clothesline on Valentine. Valentine back to his knees quickly.
I really believe that Valentine thought he was going to come out the victor of that exchange of blows. He's willing to take five or six to get one really good one in himself. But it's not happening here against Brutus, the barber Beefcake. He is getting his damaging moves in, but they're not seeming to faze the barber at all.
Two counts, two of them in a row. Beefcake with a right hand on Valentine. Greg seems to just be hanging on right now.
I think Brutus is making a mistake. You got a guy there with four limbs. On one of the limbs, he's got a big piece of hard plastic. It's the only place Brutus ain't gone for. Now, myself, that's the first thing I'd take off. First of all, we got to go to a commercial break. Then let's come back and see what we see.
The longer the belt goes, the better a chance of victory he has.
But Brutai is no fool. What Brutai is doing, he's trying to wear Greg Valentine down. Of course, that to me is the hard way of going about it. But then again, Brutus knows the hard way. So let's just check it out, because we're talking action galore, and I'd love to see Valentine get beat.
Jimmy Hart and the hammer slow to his feet. Beefcake over to Getty. At first, top turnbuckle. Beefcake relentless here. Staying on the hammer, climbing the turnbuckle, looking out of the fans here at the National Coliseum. Right hand, left side of the head. The fans counting right away with the barber. The referee being very lenient right there, Alfred.
Absolutely. I can't understand this fellow. He was allowing Barber to get away with a lot then.
And now the barber looking at the fans, signaling it's time for the sleeper hold. Valentine up. He puts Valentine's hands back down, gives him a big stomp.
A little unorthodox move there by the barber. I do believe Valentine thought he was going to try and hoist him up. Look at this.
Valentine with a big knee. And what a big rally that was, because Barber was trying to end the match.
He was. He had ideas of putting him up, putting him to sleep, and snipping away at those locks. It hasn't turned out that way. And Valentine, as we've seen him time and time again, is coming from behind, and he's gradually trying to get control of this belt. And it might be that this is the point, turning point, where he can wrest that control away from the barber.
An elbow to the back of the neck of the barber. Just when we thought Brutus the Barber was ready to put him to sleep, and all the thousands upon thousands of fans here did also, it was Valentine coming back. And now it's Barber who seems very lifeless in the ring. Greg, letting the fans know that he still has a full head of hair.
Yes, that might not last for too long, though.
That's right. Snapmare to take the man over, spring off of the left side ropes. Here he comes. And this is why they call him the Hammer, Alfred. And I know you know as well as anybody, a two count, the man is certainly a heavy hitter.
Indeed he is. That's what he relies upon, that hammer. Those tremendous right arm offensive maneuvers. He can finish you off so quickly with those. However, Beefcake still in there, still hanging on. And as we said, the belt definitely has swung now in favor of Valentine. He weathered that storm as he has weathered many, many before it. And either Beefcake didn't do his homework properly, or he's just unable to beat this man, because look at Valentine now. Oh! What a crushing right arm that is.
Another right arm. Forearm shots. Oh, that one was a club, an axe handle right on the back of the neck. Again. Oh, those are lethal blows. Down goes the barber. The leg is hooked. Brutus the Barber Beefcake kicks out again.
I think that was a fairly easy one to kick out of. Valentine doesn't have a great deal of finesse or style. And he doesn't have that technical know-how to really press home a victory like that. What he relies on is clubbing you down, and with moves like that to soften you up, whereby, in the end, he puts his little hold on you with that device that he wears on his left leg. He calls it the Heartbreaker, and it certainly is.
With that shin guard, and of course that figure four type leg lock, there it is. Has put many men down.
It has indeed, and watch him carefully, because if he does get the upper edge, what he does is he readjusts that, and he puts the front of it, which is a steel part, to the back of his calf. He wraps on that figure four, and the pain from that is, watch it, now watch it.
There it is. Just as we were talking about it, he wheels it around, feeling the end is near for the barber, and certainly the barber's prone, but he is wasting a great deal of time putting that on, Alfred.
He's wasting precious time, but he's got it there. No, he hasn't got it there.
The barber pushes out with a left leg. Valentine goes down. And Valentine, after a Beefcake again, well, he's not letting up at all, is he? Once again, he's wasting time.
He is indeed. The barber tried to get to the ropes there to pull himself out and get a safe position.
Over the top rope, down to the floor goes Greg Valentine. Jimmy Hart over to console his big man, trying to get him back in the ring.
But Brutus still down on all fours inside the ring. And don't tell me that Valentine is going to go for a high-risk move.
Oh, my goodness. Maybe a double axe handle. That's what he was trying. But Beefcake beating to the punch, with a blow to the solar plexus and down to the side of the head. The two men exchanging blows in the middle of the ring. It's Beefcake coming out ahead. Combination right and left to the face of Valentine. Boy, he is really working him over. And a big right hand.
And it looks as if the barber's got his second win. He's up and he's really running now. All that adrenaline is flowing. And now suddenly it's turned once again. And there is tremendous power and confidence in the ability of Brutus the Barber Beefcake.
A rake to the eyes. Beefcake was swinging at the referee blindly that time. A miss by the Hammer. Beefcake! Clothesline! Now, poised for the sleeper. Here it comes! He's got it!
Oh, I think we're going to see a little bit of hair cutting going on now.
Jimmy Hart up on the apron of the ring. He was going after Brutus in his bag. Valentine, double axe handle blow on the back of the Barber. And now coming for the big elbow. No, it was a forearm shot. One, two.
Oh, how did Brutus kick out of that one? It was the big Hammer. He lowered it on the Barber. He still kicked out and still on the side there is Hart going for those shears.
Jimmy Hart wants to cut the hair of the Barber. He's not worried about pinning the guy.
I think he's having trouble with it. No, he's got the zip open. He's having trouble finding the
thrown together. The roll up, two, three. Now let's get the official word.
Here's your winner, Brutus the Barber Beefcake.
Jimmy Hart cannot find the scissors, but the Barber certainly can.
He surely did. Hart got caught up inside that bag looking for the scissors and forgot all about the imminent danger that was there. Look at this. He's going for the hair.
The megaphone in one hand, the clippers in the other. The winner, Brutus the Barber Beefcake.
And that certainly was a great victory for Brutus the Barber Beefcake. What a tremendous comeback he made there towards the end of this match. Let's have a look at this. He was trying to put his heartbreaker hold on. Meanwhile, Jimmy Hart was fiddling around in the bag looking for the scissors. Up behind, here comes Brutus for that magnificent victory.
Your winner, Brutus the Barber Beefcake. More action from the NASA Coliseum of the World Wrestling Federation right after this timeout.
Brutus the Barber Beefcake doing his thing. He's something else, isn't he?
He's disgusting.
He's disgusting. Why is he disgusting? Because he didn't give you a free haircut, right?
I want a free haircut from him. Andre didn't get haircuts now.
I could get the fashion plate. He'd be willing to give you a free haircut. Freddie Blassie, I know that.
It's too late now. He's been in bed since 8.
Next week is our Halloween, and you haven't said what you're going to be.
I have to be something?
Well, it's only customary that you...
Well, let's put it this way. If I was going to be someone, I'd want to be someone with integrity, someone with intelligence.
In other words, complete opposite of what you actually are.
No.
Well, that's what I thought.
I got an idea, though. I'm going to come up with an outfit.
You got an idea, huh?
Yep. What are you going to be?
What am I going to be? I will tell you before the program is over exactly what I'm going to be, and you'll be thrilled, I'm sure.
Is the Goof in the Studio B going to play?
Oh, yeah, no question about it.
The big secret is.
What do you mean, big secret?
Well, tell me what you're going to be next week.
Next week on a Halloween program, yes. I'm going to be the most despicable person I know in the World Wrestling Federation.
You're going to wear a kilt.
I'm going to be the guy who is the walking advertisement for birth control. That's who I'm going to be. And I'm going to show you this man's inner ego. And you're going to be surprised. But next week, right here on Primetime, our feature is going to be Hercules against Dino Bravo. And don't forget, folks, mark this date down on your calendar right here on the USA Network, Sunday, November 12th. Our big, unbelievable event, Brain.
Starts at 7 o'clock.
Survivor Series Showdown. We've already given you two big matches. Tito Santana against the Big Boss Man. And, of course, Hercules against the Macho King. And next week, we'll have three more big matches for you. Hot Rod, don't forget, Halloween.
I got an idea, Bobby. Why don't you come as a man?
Oh, that would be different.
Just give it a try.
Any parting words you might have for us, Hot Rod?
Oh, just hey, Rude.
Haven't forgotten ya.
So long, everyone.
That's nice. That's real nice.